William Morrow and Harper Audio present Copper, Iron, and Clay, A Smith's Journey by Sara Dahmen. Read by Laurie Catherine Winkel. A note before we begin. Don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider or go directly to www.harpercollins.com/audio/copper-iron-clay. It contains recipes, resources, and more, and will be referred to throughout as the enhancement. Preface. I have a question for you. What are you cooking on? What is it actually made of? Where was it made? Who made it? How long will it last? Like most of us, you probably have no idea where your cookware is from, other than the big box store or catalog where you purchased it. I didn't either, for a really long time. We care so much about the food we're eating and where it came from. Let's take it a step further. Why are we cooking that fantastic organic food in a pan coated with unknown elements? Why don't we look at cookware the way we look at our food choices? Why do we purchase cookware made with mystery chemicals, but insist our vegetables are grown pesticide-free? Why do we accept that our pots fall apart and clutter landfills, but protest the tons of plastic food wrappings tossed every day? We need to take cookware to the next level. It's time to understand your cookware. Ask questions. Demand transparency, efficiency, and provenance. I personally believe a discussion about cookware is part of the conversation about food. If we are demanding to know if our food is made locally and with the least impact on the environment, we should expect the same of our cookware. We should care about where the molecular change happens to our food and be able to get answers about the ingredients in our pots and pans. The easiest way to do that is sometimes to go back to the beginning. Know who made your cookware, what it is made from, and why you are using it today. You deserve that knowledge. Cook well, and cook with meaning. Introduction. The first burn I remember getting was in my uncle's forge in the hidden hills of North Carolina backcountry, where greenery drips on top of greenery in the summer. The smash and ping of Uncle Doug's hammer echoed and bounced between the steep slopes of the mountains on the edge of the Cherokee National Forest. Like those true craftsmen of old, Uncle Doug had a spacious forge connected to the cement and aluminum box of a house where he lived with my aunt. The forge's giant doors swung open to the elements to let the fire's heat escape. Everything was covered with fluffy black soot and smelled of coal, leather, and dust. I was just about to start 12th grade and was visiting with my parents and brothers when I gamely said I wanted to try my hand at making a piece of wrought iron. I have no recollection of what I made. A nail? A cross? I still have the scar from the burn on my left index finger. It was a harbinger of things to come decades later, when I fell in love with fire and heat. But at 17, I did it more to humor Uncle Doug and give my mother a good subject for action shots of our visit. Uncle Doug had fresh aloe planted near the door, facing the sunlight, and I spent the rest of the day's visit with a gooey stick plastered to my finger, far away from the fire. I'm glad I tried it, as the memory brings a big smile. Sadly, my uncle died suddenly on March 30th, 2019. Other than brief trips to Uncle Doug's house and forge, metal wasn't part of my life at all. After college, I dove into advertising and marketing like a properly raised woman determined to use her education. My marriage at age 22 to John, my college sweetheart, brought me closer to metal, if only by way of my in-laws. My father-in-law made a living at the time by welding. In his basement, he would build everything from the toy chests in my children's rooms to impossibly tall birdhouses and fantastical creatures made from leftover scrap metal. I spent my days hard at work at an ad agency, and my evenings moonlighting as a wedding planner, while John studied for finance tests. The closest I came to cookware was when I cooked in our tiny one-bedroom apartment in Milwaukee. The kitchen had a gas stove that needed to be lit with a match, and the eating area was so small we could only fit one of those outdoor bistro tables and two chairs in it. Our wedding china remained in boxes in our parents' basements. I had a handful of pots and pans, which barely fit in cupboards jammed with our wedding gifts, plus some cheap nonstick pots from when I'd been holed up in a minuscule efficiency apartment before John and I tied the knot. This was the best we could manage, and it didn't deter me from having dinner parties, though looking back, I wonder what I thought I was accomplishing by cramming even two more bodies into that tiny kitchen and eating area. Shortly after John and I bought a house outside Milwaukee, the real estate market crashed in 2008. No one knew the extent of the damage at first, or how much it would affect nearly every industry. Also, anything that happens on the coasts seems to show up later in the Midwest. So while we didn't feel the immediate dramatic effects of the crash the way they may have in New York, our recovery was going to take far, far longer. Because of this slow crash, I didn't think it strange to make a huge life change right then. So I left my steady job with benefits at the ad agency to strike out on my own as a full-time event planner. John would say it was because I never do anything the easy way. Being a wedding planner did have its perks. Not only did I get to work with people who were usually extremely passionate about their marriage beyond the wedding day itself, but I was also able to design beautiful moments for them. Plus, I loved the tastings and food choices. I could probably write a book about the event catastrophes that happened. The cake topper fell in the catering room and the bride's head broke off. And the entire tent has collapsed in the thunderstorm. And even, I know it's 4 days before the wedding and you're almost due with a baby, but the Maharaja horse the groom needed for the ceremony just died. Still, I really loved doing weddings and events and met many wonderful people who are still friends today. Wedding planning requires more physical engagement than what is shown on television. There are silk banners to be stretched across log cabin arches, flower crowns to be glued, candles to be hung from silvery branches, and glittery name tags to be set out by every place setting. And sometimes there are last-minute panics. The bride wants to toss the bouquet! She doesn't have a toss bouquet. She didn't want one. Well, you better do something or she's going to throw that 10-pound arrangement and hurt somebody. Cue my hastily pulling flowers from a centerpiece, tying them with grass, and praying they stayed together. Moments like that leave a body feeling fresh and alive. Plus, I always love a challenge. The thrill of creative problem solving. Then the children came. First, I simply carried Will along to every meeting. Looking back, I can't believe I'd take him to restaurants where I'd sit with an engaged couple while nursing and taking notes, and then run to a rehearsal with him in tow, leaving him hanging out in a church aisle while I sprinted around to take care of some problem. No wonder he's a chill kid. When Hannah came along 2 years later, I took her to most meetings, too. Though I did try to coordinate fewer weddings, I wasn't exactly slowing down. Between working as a mom and a wedding planner, I had two full-time jobs simultaneously. In the meantime, John was eyeballs deep in studying for his chartered financial analyst certification, so things were always a little crazy around the house. John and I had always planned to have lots of kids. When we were dating, we initially thought 6, but that soon became 5. Once we realized how expensive raising children can be, and the amount of mental and physical energy that is required to take care of tiny human beings, the number was chiseled to 4. After we had Hannah, we wavered. 4 or 3? Getting pregnant and having another child proved to be far more difficult than we anticipated. It slowly became likely that I'd keep miscarrying instead of filling our bedrooms with little ones. We hoped for a third baby while friends and family, 32 women, to be exact, became pregnant and had babies. To stave off a growing panic and looming depression, I first spoke to a therapist, but then decided writing fiction would focus my energy on something that didn't have to do with babies, or lack of a positive pregnancy test. I've always loved old stories, so without much of a plan, I sat down at my computer and my first work of historical fiction shot out of me in a matter of weeks. The healing had begun. I buried myself in researching the people of the Old West, the foods they ate and the clothes they wore, and I focused less on my personal trauma. As the adage goes, once you stop watching the tea kettle, it whistles. About 9 months after I finished the novel, Jack was born. What I'd absorbed in those cozy evenings of research embedded itself into my bones. I learned about food and cooking in the 1800s and fell in love with the ways of that time. I now knew what kinds of items could be found in a traditional pioneer kitchen. There were glossy, well-worn cast-iron griddles and ovens, handmade copper pots and canteens, and fat, painted stoneware bowls. I knew the spoons would have been stained, the wood well-seasoned, the fancy tea services likely to be tin covered in black asphaltum and hand-painted with flowers and thick, wide strokes. I understood how a single pot would have been carefully groomed for the next generation, and that a woman would have been able to cook a roast or stew and bake bread or pie, all in the same cast-iron skillet. These pioneer tools became tactile to me as I wrote my stories. The frontier kitchens were in my blood. They felt solid, as if the history of the past were tangible today. It made me wonder, if a vintage pot could talk, what would it say? Would it tell me about meals cooked over a fire in the prairie? Would it divulge the secrets of a winter's night, with 12 children huddled around the hearth for both warmth and food? My experience at Uncle Doug's house wasn't unusual. My parents wanted my two younger brothers and me to have a large helping of hands-on experiences as children. We would often go to fur trade and frontier reenactments held in the small towns and villages of heavily forested northern Wisconsin where I grew up. I remember the distinct atmosphere of joy and contentment as I watched the ladies cook around their campfires. And even though the cooper might have been grumpy as he made wooden buckets, and I burned my fingers making candles, I remember fondly the long dresses the women wore, the relaxation of creamy canvas tents swaying between the pines in the forest where the reenactors set up camp. And I watched with envy as the women called in the men from their trades, or the children from running barefoot along the dirt paths, and sat down in the late, buttery sunlight for dinner, as if 1829 were still happening in front of my eyes. All those moments came into my head as I wrote fiction. And maybe that was part of the catalyst that made me start a new career, even though I didn't realize what was happening at the time. Between writing fiction and reminiscing about those soft, warm family memories, I decided rather suddenly that I wanted to create a line of cookware like what Paul Revere would have made. I knew I wanted several different types of cookware, which would include various items made of pottery, cast iron, and copper. While sourcing all these items became challenging from the very beginning, the copper cookware was by far the most intriguing part of the cookware line, and it excited me the most. But the original copperware made by copper and tinsmiths in America had mostly disappeared, and the industry was all but defunct. A lot of cast iron was mass-produced overseas, as were ceramics. Many large-scale manufacturers had gone out of business. So most people keeping these homegrown crafts alive were boutique artisans hidden away in small crafting communities or on hobby farms. The copper kettles carried overland by burly fur traders and voyagers, and given or traded with indigenous people? Those kettles were not part of any kitchen I knew anymore. Very few people even knew what they looked like. The spider skillets of early America, or those created with the smoke ring along the bottom to fit the American pot-bellied stove, may be on eBay. These designs, which were, at their deepest heart, American, were gone. Before the 20th century, cookware was pure and simple. It was made completely of clay, iron, and soft metals such as copper and tin. There were no plastics sprayed on the pans, no paint, and no strange concoctions of different enzymes and complicated alloys. Cookware was made organically and with natural elements from the land. Likely it was made by one of your neighbors. It was basic. But in the early 1900s, cooking schools had started using aluminum and stainless steel in their classes, especially after the Ideal Home Exhibition in the United Kingdom in 1909 unveiled a plethora of steel cookware. By the time Teflon came around in the mid-1940s, stainless steel had taken the place of copper and cast iron in the kitchen. Stainless was considered a prestigious commodity because of its use during World War I and World War II. Today, many people still assume they should pay quite a decent amount of money for a good, thick set of stainless steel, even though it is not expensive to make this cookware. That mentality is born from a generational understanding of the specialness of stainless, which was due to the war effort and need. Crazy how our battles from decades ago still influence our choices in metals. But although aluminum and stainless steel cookware took over most...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.